What's up, my man?
Not much, man.
What's happening? Thanks for doing this.
Yeah, I appreciate you having me.
It's been a cool summer for you?
Yeah, it's been interesting.
Yeah.
We start with, in March, we kind of get things rolling with our off season in terms of knowing who's going to be with us and, you know, who won't be with us. So, you know, the winter is, a lot of people don't understand, what makes this time the most gratifying for me is all the buildup and all the preparation that we do during the winter time. So it's watching a lot of film. It's seeing what players we might have, what players we might not have. So there's a lot of film that I go through on certain players that I never even end up working with.
Oh, really?
Yeah. So you don't really know until the last second, because... So
how do you have a gauge of who you're going to have coming in?
You don't. You have no idea, because this, I mean, the whole industry in terms of what players are signing with what agency, it's all dependent on that, who I work with pre-draft. So my pre-draft process is set up primarily through Roc Nation. So Roc Nation, of course, has a list of targets that they go after. Some of those meetings I'm in on, other meetings I'm not. So it's like you think you have this kid, and last second, he ends up somewhere else. And then you might get another kid that you're not prepared for, and then you have to kind of like quickly do all your homework and make sure you're ready when they walk in the door. And whether
that's a weird business for me, I can imagine myself, man, if I didn't know who I'm interviewing, say months in advance, and then all of a sudden that would just spur some like anxious feelings.
super
gotten pretty good at like just going with the flow and allowing things to kind of unfold.
Yeah, you know, I mean, I've been doing this now for 3 or 4 years, so I know that as soon as you expect something to happen, it usually doesn't, and then vice versa. There's some great things that come through the door and you never would have expected it to happen. So I think it's just being prepared all around. Yeah. And I think watching film on every different kind of athlete and player and system has made me more of a complete trainer. So I'm usually prepared. It doesn't really matter what wrench is thrown in there. I'm usually prepared to kind of adjust and go from there.
Yeah, you've said, I mean, 3 to 4 years, it's long, but it's not that long. So
it's
you're just kind of getting started. So this is cool that we get to talk, because in 5 years from now, you'll be in a maybe whole different place.
Right.
So how does this summer compared to kind of last summer? It seems like you've been doing similar work, but did it really take off? Kind of like feels as if you've almost arrived,
right,
from the outside looking in, at least.
Well, I felt like I built up a lot of momentum last summer.
Yeah.
And it was tough because, you know, last year it was really, really tough for me from a mental standpoint, from a personal standpoint. It was probably the toughest year of my life.
Why?
All around. I went through a divorce.
Really?
And then I lost my best friend. So, and that was all in a matter of 4 months. So I lost literally two best friends within the matter of 4 months. Obviously, one being my wife and the other one being my best friend that I, you know, had since freshman year of college. So, you know, a lot of people don't understand. They take this big macro view of seeing my social media or seeing who I'm with or seeing who I train, and they're like, man, this life is amazing and this is what I want. And they didn't realize behind the scenes, when you kind of peel back the layers, there was a lot mentally and emotionally I was going through. So I used basketball and I used my passion for what it is to kind of escape. You know, that was kind of like, even when I was in high school or grade school, whenever I needed to just get away, it would just be me in a basketball and a hoop. And in a sense, that was kind of the same thing for me during that rough time.
Man, I lost a friend this year and lost a girlfriend. So it's so different. It's a micro version of what you went through. It wasn't my best friend, but that can change everything in the way you view life.
And right.
It's like the world under you kind of just moves.
Mm-hmm.
So your constant was basketball.
Right.
Was there ever times when like basketball wasn't enough to kind of keep you level-headed? Or?
You know, of course. I mean, there's times where you just can't escape it.
Yeah.
It is what it is. That's people don't understand that life... To me, I think now that I'm in a great spot mentally and emotionally and spiritually, that I didn't realize just how important that is to do what I do at a high level and do it consistently.
Yeah.
You know, because there's going to be days where you're up and down and it, you never know what's going to happen. But I think that going through that and trying to deal with that was, you know, the toughest part of what I did. And I think it made me better, a better person. It made you realize that, you know, no matter what it looks like at the end of the day from outside, it's more about your happiness and what you're trying to do to accomplish each day and kind of reach your end goal that way.
It's a crazy perspective builder, at least for me it was. Is there anything that now that you've talked about, like, you have a holistic approach almost, it seems like, to what you do now. A lot of what I talk about is that. It's like, you can't be good at what you do if all the other boxes aren't kind of at least in order.
Mm-hmm.
Is there anything that is a something that you do to kind of maintain that now, or is it almost just a...
No,
you got shook to your core, it sounds right. like, and then now that's your baseline.
Well, I think for me, you know, I grew up in a home that was, you know, we would go to church every Sunday. You know, I went to a Lutheran grade school, yeah. almost went to a Lutheran high school.
Yeah.
You know, I was the youngest sibling, so we were always around that.
Yeah,
but I think that when you're going through something tough like that, especially a divorce and whatever it might be, or you split up, it doesn't matter what it is, the initial reaction is to blame the other person,
yeah.
right? You want to deflect blame, and you want to make it seem like you're not the one at fault. So I think that me getting away from my core values of God and Jesus and being spiritual with who I am, I think once I took a step back and realized as the man in the relationship, it was my job to keep us center with our beliefs. So in that sense, once I realized that I didn't do my part with that. So that for me, I don't ever have regrets. That's my thing. I go through life and I do the best I can with each step. So I don't look back at the end of the day and be like, man, I should have done this or this or that. You can always look at it that way. But once I start realizing that I have to hold myself more accountable, then it made me a better round person, trainer, mentor, whatever it might be. Because at the end of the day, these athletes, in order for them to improve, they have to be honest with themselves first.
Yeah.
It can't always be the referees, the coach, the system, my teammates. At some point, you got to look at, what are you doing?
Yeah.
You know,
it's extreme ownership.
Yeah.
So with extreme ownership and the work that you do, I can see that it's easy to get tied up into your player's success.
Mm-hmm.
And where's that line between taking ownership for, or like taking, you know, this is my fault or it's not my fault, not having regrets, but moving forward with your players, where's that line to like, I've done the best I could do and what happens now is his or hers,
right.
You know, it's in their shoes, like where's that line?
Well, you know, I tell my players all the time, a lot of the players I work with now are extremely gifted,
yeah,
right? They're going to end up in the NBA or WNBA, whether they are trained by myself or by my grandma, you know?
That's
like their elite level got them there.
Yeah.
My thing is, how do we get them to their peak quicker,
yeah.
and how do we keep them at their peak longer? So as long as we're working on the right things, and that goes back to preparation, is we're not reinventing anything,
that's
right?
True.
There's a ton of blueprints out there. What does this specific blueprint look like for this certain player, right? Not everyone's the same. So for me, I have a supreme belief in what I do and how I prepare, that once we go through our entire off season of what we're trying to accomplish, once they get to the year, I've gotten to the point where I'm relaxed.
That's
I know
nice.
What we worked. Yeah, I know what we worked on was the right stuff. Now there's times where you have to help them emotionally through different things or make them still believe in themselves. If they start losing their confidence, then it's a whole another issue.
How'd you get that self-belief, man? That's something from the outside looking in. It seems like you just have a way, like a presence about you. And I'm like, dude, this guy just popped out within the last couple of years.
Right.
And here he is working with some of the best players in the world. But you have a complete conviction about everything that you do. And that's something that I admire.
Right.
You know, it's trying to make yourself in a space, anybody, it requires a sense of conviction that what I'm doing is the right thing to be doing. Like, where'd that come from?
You know, it's funny because, so my dad and my mom, they own a mortgage business.
Mine too.
Yeah.
Okay.
So
here we go.
That was always in my back pocket.
Mortgage, really?
I always thought I was going to end up doing that.
Whoa.
Which is weird. Like literally from like the age of 10 on. And I was like, all right, this is what I'm going to be doing. And
I was like, mortgages are boring. I don't
horrible,
want to, but in the back
horrible.
Door. Yeah,
but
yeah.
I didn't realize I was preparing myself for this current role I'm in from the time I can remember, because there were three players that I watched over and over and over again. And right when I was growing up, and this is gonna date myself a little bit, is when DVR like first came out, right?
Yeah, yeah.
It's like, oh my God, you can pause it, you can rewind.
Dang.
I took advantage of that more than anyone, because it was Steve Nash, it was Darren Williams, and it was Kobe Bryant. And those were the three I watched over and over
those
and over.
Two of my three right there.
Yeah, so I just kept rewinding. I'd go out and I'd literally stand up in our living room and work on the footwork without a ball.
Mm.
I looked like I had issues.
It's
right?
Some high level stuff.
Yeah. And then I'd go out on the driveway and I'd work on it. I didn't realize that me, I just looked at the game a different way.
Yeah.
And doing that from a young age and learning that, I didn't realize that's what I was going to end up doing forever. So I think it's more so confidence that I've always looked at the game in that sense. So yeah. It's like, yeah, I've only been working out players for 5 years, but I've been training myself, and along with my dad, he trained me as well. I've been doing this since I was 10. You know, so now we're talking about 20 years now. So that's the way I look at it. That's where it all comes from.
Man, tell me, let's talk about Steve Nash real fast. Yeah. Just because I'm a fan for Steve Nash, man. And I feel like Kobe, you know, everybody talks about Kobe. Darren Williams was awesome. What are the main things that you learned from Steve Nash? This guy's one of my favorite players. I modeled my game after him, being a smaller white point guard.
Yeah.
Unathletic. I'm like, I can do that. Whatever right. that is.
I think it was his deception of how to come off ball screens and how did he get to his spots every time. Because for me, again, being a white point guard and not usually overimposing athletically from the guy that I'm going to be facing up every night,
exactly.
You have to learn those little tricks.
Yeah.
And it's like, okay, this guy was a two-time MVP. When you're insane. Picking teams at recess, he's probably not coming off the board at number one, right?
Yeah.
So how did he get to where he is, and how was he so efficient with everything he did? So it was just trying to look at little stuff. Not like, oh, that was a dope move, but like, how did he get to that point to get this guy off balance? Mm. That's the way I think of it. Mm. It's like, okay, what did he do initially to get him on his heels? Mm. Then what was the point where he knew he had to do this? So that's just like with Steve, and every guard and every player, that's kind of the way I view things.
You're on a different level. I would see it as like, oh, that's a beautiful hesitation move. I can add that.
Right.
Hesitation is such a big part of what I used to do. But you would start with even before that move even developed.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
I even look at him now, man. Like, even how he used to sit on the bench was like some higher level stuff. Like, I'm in the mind-body stuff and how even chairs can really screw up our hips and ankle mobility. He would just be laying on the floor. So he was ahead of his time, man.
Oh, yeah.
But pivot a little bit. So you're training some of the best players in the world. Give me like a brief synopsis, man. How'd you become an NBA skills trainer? You were working on your footwork in the driveway way before you should have been.
Yeah. So
how'd it evolve?
My journey is different. It's crazy. So my freshman year at UMKC, I went to UMKC, University of Missouri, Kansas City. My college roommate is Kirk Korver. Kirk was my best friend, and who passed away a couple years ago. Kirk's older brother is Kyle Korver, plays currently for the Bucks. He just got picked up by the Bucks. So Kirk and I grew extremely tight. Had no idea that was what I was going to do, but we maintained our really tight relationship. And then fast forward, I went and played in Germany a year. I came home and I worked with Drew Hanlon, and Drew currently trains a lot of guys like Joel Embiid, Jason Tatum, Bradley Beal. He grew up in St. Louis with me. So I actually asked him just to train me for a workout, just to steal some stuff and ideas. And he kind of presented me with this idea of him wanting to add trainers and build up this company now known as Pure Sweat. So I was like, all right, yeah, I'll do it. So I came home, got home in mid-March from playing in Germany, and then started training kids and really, really enjoyed it. And I thought, like, I think I can do this at a really, really high level.
What did you enjoy about it?
I think for me, I reached my peak, right? I filled up in terms of potential-wise. I got to where I wanted to go.
Yeah.
I knew I wasn't going to be an NBA player, but I played at the highest level I thought I could have.
Yeah.
And at that point, I was ready for a new challenge, and I was ready to help players now get to their goals. So once I started doing that, I kind of decided pretty quickly, I'm done playing. Because I was training from 8 to 3 every day, and then I would train myself for 3 hours after that. And I was just exhausted. So I went through that for a month and a half before I finally decided, I can just do this. And I think if I start this sooner, I can get to the top a little quicker. So once I started doing that, Doug McDermott, who was close with the Korvers, he was my first NBA client to give me a shot. And people don't realize, like, oh, he just started with NBA guys and he was paid all this money and it was amazing, and then he got so and so and so and so. It doesn't work like that. For me, I had to pay my dues. So like with Doug, I said, listen, you're on your first contract. This was after his rookie year of the Bulls. Don't pay me until you get your next contract. Did the same thing with Bobby Portis. Don't pay me until you get your next contract.
How long was that?
3 years.
Wow.
I worked for free for 3 years. They offered to pay multiple times, but I said, I gave you my word, this is what it is. So I don't deserve any piece of what got you here right now, because I didn't help you get this. But I want to help you get to the next step. How do we get you from here to here? So I think for me it was, you know, everyone says, well, I want to do what you do. Great. Are you willing to train for free for 3 years? Are you willing to train grade school kids for free? Like, how I started was I ran free clinics for 2 months straight just to get my name out there, just to prove that I knew what I was doing and I could help each individual player get better. And that's what people don't see. Now they see, you know, the Kyries, the Carmelos, the Kobes, and they're like, oh, this is dope. This is what I want to do. Yeah, I bet. There's a lot that goes into it, though.
But Alex, this is the devil's advocate. But yeah. Alex, I have a rent, dude. I have this to do. I have that to do.
Yeah.
What would you do? How do you make ends meet, man?
So there's a bunch of different ways, man. You can live with your parents. It is what it is, right? Are you willing to swallow your pride and you live with your parents?
For real, that's real pride.
And build up your income. So for me, once I started with those 2 months of getting my name out there, then I started having players that were consistently paying in the area. Mm. Now that allowed me to pay for travel, to pay for meals on the road. I would usually stay with my players, so I might crash on the couch or if need be, go grab a hotel room. But a lot of it was just built up through my local players and my local academy. So we went from the first year having 60 kids, the next summer having 150, and then the third summer, when it was really rolling, we had 240 players that were training year-round. And it was literally 8 to 8 every single day.
So in the meantime, it was just do what you had to do.
Yeah.
But it sounds like, as you were talking about it, you're like, I'm going to go with this because I might be able to get to the top faster if I start now.
Yeah.
So that's something that interests me with someone that has, quote-unquote, you know, success. I put parentheses because it's such a cheesy term.
Yeah. Like,
there was a thought process to it. A lot of people, you know, say, I would have never imagined I'm doing what I'm doing right now.
Mm-hmm.
Was that kind of your state, or was it more like, I'm going into this with hopes that I'll eventually be working with someone like Kyrie and all
Yeah.
This?
No, I mean, you never really imagine that you're going to be working with literally the top, right? You don't. It doesn't matter. You can say what you want. It doesn't matter how confident you are in yourself. Yeah. But to get here this quickly, I think, is more of a testament of my patience. I didn't take pictures of every single player that I work with that walked in the door to try to use someone's name to build myself up.
That's what I liked about you too.
I just was trying to be as patient as I could, build relationships,
quiet,
do things the right way, stay low key. And then everything works out in the end. I'm a big believer in you put in the right work, you treat people the right way. At the end of the day, God's going to put you in positions to kind of show whether you're good enough or not. And that's what my thing was, is if I can just get in the door, then it comes down to whether I'm good enough or not. But I want to give myself a chance to get that opportunity.
I'm inspired by that, man. And just hearing you waiting 3 years with some of those clients to kind of even get paid.
Mm-hmm.
And I keep coming back to confidence, man. Like, you just had this sense of confidence because of the time that you put in.
Yeah. Well, and also you have to earn trust, you know?
And so much what you do is built off relationships. I've heard you say that before.
Yeah.
And I'm sure this market is very easy for people to have the players be aware that, like, I can tell that you're trying to build a relationship with me. Every trainer's been, like, taking pictures of who they're with.
Right.
Like you said, promoting that, which I understand. I'm in the marketing media space. But to what extent, or how do you make sure that relationship is genuine? How do you make sure that you're felt with the players and you don't come off as, I'm just acting genuine so that you X, Y, Z for me?
Well, you know, for me, it's just being honest. Yeah. You know, it doesn't matter what you say, right? But it's more about how it's perceived and whether they feel it or not.
Yeah.
So for me, I could be as completely dead honest with everyone I know or everyone I come across, and there could be one or two people that are like, nah, he's full of it. And there, you have no control over that. So all you can really do is say, for me, how do I help you, right? So Carmelo, how do I help you? What do you need from me? What are your goals? Dope, those are mine now. You know what I mean? So it's like, Trae, what's your goal this year, man? Tell me what it is. And now let me help you get there. Because that, for me, it's like everyone's different. Everyone has different things that push them. Everyone has different trigger points in terms of how to get the most out of them, how to kind of build their confidence, you know, what they like, what they don't like, what you can get away with in workouts, what you should stay away from. And it's getting to know the person. I can't train or I can't help someone get as good as they want to get if I don't know them individually. Because then I don't know how they tick, right?
How do you kind of get to know them?
It's just little talks, yeah. You know, and we might go grab dinner and then just be real. Like, okay, well, why did you struggle in this scenario? right? What about this game put you out of your comfort zone? And here's what the biggest thing is what I always ask my athletes is, if you were put in a scenario that would make you the most uncomfortable, what would it be? Because a lot of players have a lot of pride, right? Like, nothing. I can do whatever I want.
Yeah.
No, that's not true. That's not true. What is it?
That's a great...
You know? So it's like, once you start peeling back all that, and once they feel like they can tell you anything, whether it's their relationship, whether it's their homies, whether it's their agent, whether it's the game, I'm just here as... Sometimes you just got to be a sounding board. Because,
yeah.
I, you know, I went through it. There's times where I'm frustrated. I want to talk about the game. There's other times I don't want to talk about anything. I know what I did wrong. I want to move on. I don't want to think about it. So it's like, once you understand whether to, hey, hit them up right away after the game, or let's give them 48 hours to kind of sit back and relax and get away from everything.
Yeah. That's cool. You've developed this intuitive, empathetic ability. It's very, I'm all into psychology and the mind and all that kind of stuff. So what you do sounds like it's a lot of working with people's minds.
Yeah.
Is it kind of... Are NBA players as, you know, as human as maybe people don't want to think they are?
Yeah.
It's easy to think, you know, Trae Young, you know, he can take all the heat. But I was just reading an article this morning. There's all this mental health, like NBA just announced that they'll be bringing on, you know, mental health experts to every team.
Yeah.
And I did some research, and one of the first things that popped up was this article about how Trae Young, you know, one of your clients, he had so much people, just like the whole country turned on him when he came to the league. You know, everybody loved me.
Mm-hmm.
Now everybody's trying to talk shit and tell me that I'm too small, I'm not good enough, like all this. How much of what you do is dealing with that kind of stuff?
Well, I mean, that's what I tell my players all the time. Like the more success that you accumulate and build, it's you have a ton of hate that's following, right? Because everyone's trying to pull you down, and it might not even be about you. A lot of times it's about the person that's coming after you, right? You know how that is. So a lot of it is just trying to stay off social media as much as you can, because that can turn into a whirlwind of creating self-doubt for no reason. It's a lot of opinions of people that don't really matter. So I've gotten to the point personally to where it's, you know, I enjoy your company. I might enjoy being around my family or my parents, or it at the end of the day, it's like, my opinion of what I want to do and the way I want to do it and the path I want to take, that's me, right? I'm not going to let anyone else, what they might think about it, dictate my actions, because I'm a big believer in there's one person that's going to judge me at the end of the day. He ain't here, right?
Yeah.
So for me, it's as long as I'm living by that and going by my own morals, everyone else is going to kind of fall in line, and they may think where they may. You know, I can't control that, so I'm not going
to
try to.
I really like that. And so you try to shed that to your clients a little bit and say, hey, maybe get off social media. For me, I share so much of the things, like this conversation will be shared on social media, and it's such a powerful tool to learn and connect, but then also it can be very toxic. So I've had to set up things where I just like am not on it for most of the hours of the day, because like you said, it's this comparison game. I can look up Alex and be like, oh, I thought I had a great day, but here's Alex training with Kyrie. What am I doing?
Tough.
Yeah.
You know, there's
set up those boundaries.
Yeah. Well, and that's, I used to be bad at that because I felt like I want to do this at the top level. And then I see other people doing it.
Exactly.
And it's like, man, what, why am I not there right now? And then like, then it becomes toxic, and then it leads into other parts of your life. So for me, it was, let me control what I can control. Right. Let me go out of the way to make sure I'm doing each step by step by step by step. Don't skip it, because there's parts of it of saying no. Like when people, I would get no's all the time. Like I'll reach out to clients, I'll reach out to agents, and they're like, nah, we're good.
Really?
We don't think you're right for them.
Yeah.
And that's good with me, you know, because now that builds another competitive fire in me to where it's like, all right, we'll see.
Wow.
We'll see. So, you gotta balance it. You know, some players might go on there and they might see all the negative talk and it fuels them, right?
And because you did that, it seems like you didn't take any shortcuts. Like you're following your compass. And because of that, do you think when you had maybe your first client or your first huge client, that also was a level of not having doubt? Because the question I had coming in was like, did you ever deal with like, have you heard of imposter syndrome? Like, who am I to be doing this?
Right.
Did you like? It sounds like because you took that approach, because you had that mentality, imposter syndrome maybe didn't have the room to squeeze in, because you know, I put in the steps, you know, it took longer than maybe I thought.
Right. No, I think it was trying too hard. So for with my first client being Doug, I was trying too hard to make sure he was happy, or I was doing things the right way, or I was making sure that that he was enjoying what it doesn't, you know, for me, it's like once I started treating my NBA players the way I'd treat a fifth grader that walked in the door, that's when my success or success, whatever you want to call it, really like it went off, because it wasn't about, oh, this is an all-star. No, it's just that this is another human being that I need to help, that they're coming to me for guidance for. So how do I get them from point A to point B? Once I stopped caring about who it is I was training from like a macro standpoint, then it helped me become a better trainer, and it made my relationships with my athletes grow even higher, because I don't care about all that stuff.
You have no idea how much this is translating to me. I'm like, my gears are turning, how this can apply to so many aspects of my life. But that's the cool thing about basketball or training. You can talk about this, and I'm applying it to so many different things in my life. I have one question, you know, like, you got a text from Kobe Bryant.
Yeah.
You got a call from Kobe Bryant, and you denied it. Tell me about that.
So it was interesting. So my girlfriend, my current girlfriend, this was 2 years ago. We went, or a year and a half ago, we went down to Huntington Beach. He's a big UConn fan. Nafisa was at UConn at the time. So he asked her to come down and work out in front of the girls, in front of his sixth grade team at the time. So we went down there and I trained her for about an hour, and it was literally just Kobe and his team watching. And for me, being a Kobe fan growing up, I was probably more nervous than she was.
Yeah.
So I'm putting her through her full workout, and we get done, and you know, I got to talk to him for about 30 minutes. And what you don't think about who was the person that you followed growing up, whoever it might be. I was more worried that he was going to be a jerk, and then it would cloud my entire like childhood and be ruined because of it. But he was awesome. He was just the opposite. He was open. He was asking any questions. He was great with Nafisa, with myself, and we had a couple guys there helping and took pictures. I thought that was the end of it. So fast forward a month and a half, I get a call from Newport, and I usually don't answer numbers I don't know.
Yeah.
Newport Beach, declined. Like 5 minutes later, shoots me a text, hey, this is Kobe, give me a call when you can. I didn't have his number, obviously, but Nafisa did, so I text her, I'm like, hey, is this who I think it is? And she's like, yep. So, of course, give it about 10 minutes, keep it cool, call him back. So he's like, yeah, I want you to come down and train my daughter's team for this weekend. And so ever since then, we've obviously grown extremely tight, and I've been working out his daughter and their team for a year and a half running now.
Really?
Yeah.
Do you continue to learn from him, kind of in a different sense?
Every single time. I think I learned something new every single time I'm with him. And a lot of it is just predicated on me being a nerd and asking questions.
Yeah.
And he obviously thinks at an entirely different level than most people. And I think he enjoys those conversations because it gets him back into, yeah, this is what I know, this is what I love.
Yeah.
So we kind of get to bounce ideas off each other. I think being around him has made me a better trainer, not for my pros in a standpoint, but more so for my younger players, because that's who I deal with all the time when I'm around him. And he said, think about when a young kid is trying to learn a new language. They can pick it up much quicker than someone like you or I, mm-hmm. because their brain's still developing.
Yeah.
He said, so in a sense of basketball training, instead of trying to dumb everything down and keep it simplified for a younger player, obviously they need fundamentals, but let's throw the kitchen sink at them and let's see how much they can absorb and sync up. And it's crazy because now that I've started doing that for a year and a half, I can see his team and his players have grown so much more than even a player at the NBA or WNBA level. They're going to skyrocket here, and a player in the NBA or WNBA is going to be going here, because their brain, from a sense, is almost maxed out in terms of development. So it's going to take them much longer of a route to get there than the seventh grade girls.
You think that's the trajectory of kind of how the sport's going right now, is that these kind of high-level moves and high-level trainers just aren't going to reach the younger demographics?
That's the goal. I mean, the goal is...
It seems like the game's progressing really fast.
Yeah.
The
goal is to make sure everyone's training the right way.
Yeah.
And I think with Kobe backing it, and now with the athletes that I'm training, that I just show they're working on, it's nothing crazy, but it's all simplified footwork, and everything has a purpose. So if they see a player like Trae or a player like Candace Parker working on a move, and now there's a 10th grader that's watching it on Instagram, like, oh, I want to try that, instead of trying to juggle 8 tennis balls and throw frisbees and throw on, you know, it's gotten a little bit out of hand from that sense. So I think, and it's getting back to the fundamentals while incorporating the difficult moves that everyone can learn. I don't care how old you are.
So you said you nerd out with Kobe?
Yeah.
What else do you nerd out about, man? What are you super curious about? What are some fields or like aspects of the game or even beyond the game that you can't learn enough about? Does anything come to mind?
I don't know, because my life is so... Nafisa gets on me a lot because it's all I ever want to talk about. Like, I'll go to the gym, I'll be there, and then I'll come home, and then I'm just sitting there thinking about, man, what about this move with this player that I can do? I wonder if they're going to pick that up right away.
You had a caption that I found super interesting. You said, like, imagination is the basis of something. Do you remember that?
I don't know. No. I throw out a lot of quotes. I don't know.
But imagination, what are you just saying? Like, you go home and just imagine this kind of stuff.
So here's... And
I wouldn't have expected that from you because you're such a low-key vibe.
Yeah. So,
but you're creative.
Yeah, for me, and this is how I've grown as well, is you can't put players like this in a box all the time.
Yeah.
You know, their creativity and their imagination within the game is always going to be what makes them great. The game is very instinctual. And that's where I'm trying to get my athletes to understand is, okay, let's work on these things. But don't be a robot about it. If you feel like you need to want to try something different, do it. Just react and play. I want to build up your foundation, and then I want your talent to take that foundation and branch off however you feel like it should. Mm. Right? So, you know, just having players constantly think about, okay, well, what if this happens? Well, then you got to figure it out. Well, what if this happens? Okay, well, then you could try this. So it's constant read and react, problem solve, on the move. You know, and I think that's what makes a lot of the players I work with great, is because they're so instinctual with it.
Is there anyone that stands out to you that almost like surprised you in any way? Like, I mean, I'm just so curious about like Trae and Kyrie specifically being an ex-point guard.
Yeah.
Did anything about them surprise you about their process, about how they show up? About
No, I think that...
Were you blown away by their attention to detail?
Yeah, I think... Kai is at another level than Trae in terms of his maturity. He's been through a lot more stuff than Trae has.
Trae's still
learning, and a lot of it's just going to come with going through seasons and going through games where he's gaining that experience. And Kai's kind of been through everything, right? He's been in NBA finals. He's been through injuries. He's dealt with adversity. He's dealt with a new system. He's dealt with a new city. And Trae's still getting entrenched in all that.
And how is that dealing with someone like Kyrie, who's been through so much? How do you still connect to him as a trainer and be like, I can still help you?
I think I
can see being Kyrie and being like, what are you going to do for
me
at this point?
Well,
I'm
funny.
All time.
We talked about that. We're talking about, you know, in terms of the most skilled players ever, he's probably on one hand, right? Maybe on two fingers, right? So what do I do to help him?
Yeah.
So then it becomes less of, here's my opinion, here's the facts. So then I can lay out facts to him. Here's what you're not doing. Here's what you're doing well. Here's what you're not doing well. Right? So then it's like, how do we make this all around complete? And then it's having a conversation with him again about being real. It's like, well, what do you want to improve? What do you feel like you're missing? So then it's like a balance of both. Because at the end of the day, every player knows, it doesn't matter how talented you are. You need someone there that's watching over, because you can't see what you're doing.
Yeah.
You can't see if your footwork's right or if your balance is where it needs to be or if your release point's where it needs to be. So even Tiger Woods, he's had a caddy every tournament, right? Yeah. You need that secondary help and reinforcement too.
That's true.
It doesn't matter what level player you are.
Yeah.
So I think of the fact that a player like Kyrie and a player like whoever it might be, they put their personal ego aside to reach their end goal.
That's important.
Right? You don't want to, like I said before, you don't want to have a regret. It's like, man, I had so much pride where I wouldn't let anyone help me. And maybe I missed out on a couple rings, or maybe I missed out on this or that. So then it's like, at the end of the day, I did everything I could. Now I can live with what happened.
Do you have anybody like that for you? Like, you can't, I like that because I tell myself that too. It's natural for me to want to put my head down and do everything myself.
Yeah.
So I love the quote, you can't see the forest from the trees.
Mm-hmm.
Do you have anybody that's keeping an eye out for you? Like, hey, this is where you're at, because where you're at is such a unique space.
You know? Yeah.
So there's not a lot of people.
Well, you can't, I mean, it doesn't matter what you do, you can't get there by yourself. I don't care how talented you are. So I think it's not so much from a work standpoint of needing help, but just times where I need to vent, or times where I might need business help, right? So my dad, he's ran a business, and he's been someone I'm tighter with than anyone in terms of that level of conversation. So I'm always bouncing ideas off of, and it's someone that I can, I'll be honest with you. If I get a call tomorrow from, it doesn't matter who it is. It could be Kevin Durant. It could be Kawhi Leonard. I'm gonna call my dad right away because it's still cool. It doesn't matter what level you get. Still, you have to take a step back and say, damn, what I'm doing is really cool. And it's funny. We talked about this. We talked about this the other day. Myself and Derek, who's now doing all my business stuff. we had to talk about, man, it's grind week, and we're like, is it really grind week? Like, you know, there's people out in 100 degree weather doing construction. We're in an air conditioned gym. We were complaining that we had to walk to the car and it was like 90 out, and the AC wouldn't crank up quick enough. So it's all about perspective. But I think to go back to your question of who's there to help me, my biggest sounding board is Nafisa. And she helped me a lot. Yeah, that's my girlfriend. So she's helped me a lot through. She was there because she was a client originally.
Oh, really?
And I moved to New York right after my divorce because I wanted a fresh start.
Yeah.
I wanted to build my business there and kind of do things the right way and get things from the ground up from NBA standpoint. And Connecticut being 2 hours away, I'd drive to there. I would train her. I would drive back. So we started going to dinners and talking because she really helped me through my tough time of, I was extremely depressed. I would sit in my hotel room, I would cry, I would, question where I was as a person spiritually.
How old were you at this point?
26 and a half.
Yeah.
Yeah. So it was tough. And having her through that, it's now everything that falls onto my plate, she's usually the one that has to deal with it. And a lot of people don't understand because she's only 22 or 23. I should know that, but I know her birthday, so that's all that really matters, right? So she's, in terms of age level, she's where I am, if not even a little older in terms of maturity level. So just having her has helped me with everything aside from basketball.
I could see that you'd be the type maybe to be, like you said, go home, think about this all the time, always piecing it together. And for me, I'm naturally that way. So I have to train myself to let things go sometimes or turn off at a certain point.
Right. It's tough.
Do you have a thing that you do, or is it, that sounds like she almost acts as your escape sometimes. She acts as your, I can breathe now, I can relax. Is that important for you in your process?
Yeah. I mean, I was so entrenched in what we were doing from a business standpoint 24/7 that once I went through my divorce, I realized that, again, looking back at myself, I've got to do things differently. It's not on her, that's on both of us. What did I do that could have been better? So now with Nafisa, it's like, okay, I have to delegate. I have to be willing to give up some control, and I'm a control freak,
within your business.
Within my business. Yeah. So I have to, that's why, Dave's doing what he's doing. He's rocking out. I got Derek that's taking over all my business in terms of St. Louis, emails, facilities. So I can go home and I can get back and I can relax and I can FaceTime Nafisa for an hour if I want to, or if I can give her a call, or we can go to a movie, or we can watch Netflix. Or I can go travel and see her on a weekend. And before, I wouldn't have done that because I was so worried about my business. But I've gotten to the point where the people that I'm with trust me, and the people that I'm around are good people, and everyone's looking out in the best interest of each individual client. So now, I have the luxury of getting away from all that and kind of doing what I want
to
do.
I'm excited for that day, man. I'm excited to start delegating, because I'm reading this book called Deep Work, and it even says that they've measured people who, are somewhat checking in with their work even in downtime hours.
Yeah.
And then they measure their productivity the next day, and it's those people that often can just kind of stop things even for just a couple hours. It absolutely affects your cognitive ability the next day. So your ability to unplug and to delegate to David here and whoever else actually helps probably your ability to do your job where it matters most.
Well, I mean, we had a big conversation the other night with our whole, we're calling this our team. Like our team, it's not me, this is our team. How do we all get to where we want to go? So having all these guys around me, it just makes me, it puts me in a better spot emotionally. And then I can, I can go to church on Sundays and I can think about what the message was. How does that pertain to my life? How do I get one person to learn from this message this week? That all of a sudden now they might tell someone, or they might tell someone. So now it's like, you know, my job on this earth isn't, I wasn't put here to train basketball players, right? I was put here to spread his word and to take others up there with me by the time I'm done. So once I got back to that level of focus, I think it just made me happier, and it made me more confident, and made me more secure. Because at the end of the day, I don't care if I'm training or doing mortgages or, you know, doesn't matter, or doing construction, it doesn't matter. At the end of the day, you know, my number one goal is to get there. So everything else is just icing on the cake for me.
Yeah.
And for me, I got to put myself in the right position to, everyone's got goals. Everyone wants to do certain things in their life, and I'm very goal oriented. But not getting a client isn't going to ruin my day, right? Or if someone decides, nah, I need to do something else, I need to work with someone else, that's not going to ruin my day.
So what are some of your goals? Seems like, I'm from the outside, you know, I'm like, dude, what kind of goals must you have, you know?
Yeah.
Like, you've done it. You're training Kyrie Irving, you're training Trae Young, some of the best players in the world. What else could there be?
So, I had a conversation the other day about this. I used to be to the point where, okay, at the end of this year, I want to have 3 NBA clients, and I want to make this much amount on my academy. I want to have this many players in the academy. Now, I'm to the point of, the less I plan out, the more stuff that seems to roll around. Mm. Because you can plan for something, but at the end of the day, if something else comes along, then
yeah,
a whole wrench can be thrown into your plan. Mm. So you have to be okay with that. And I'll tell you a conversation that I've had, and this is, for me, it's more about priorities than it is about goals. What are your priorities first? So a dead honest conversation that I've had with Kobe, that I've had with Kyrie, that I've had with Carmelo, all these new people that have been around or new clients that have came through, I've had a conversation where I've said, listen, my number one priority is not you. My number one priority is my faith and the FISA. So those are my priorities, and everything else falls in line after, and we can have a conversation about what that looks like. Mm. So once you're honest with who you're across from and honest with yourself about what it is that makes you happy, and those are the two things that puts me in the best place personally.
How does your priorities affect your goals? Kind of like, how does that actually affect your life? Like, I can see you talking to these people and saying that, but what does that mean for me, you know? Does that mean that,
well,
I draw a boundary between work and you?
Yeah.
What does that mean?
No, it just means that you have to be okay telling them no. Mm. Right? There's a lot of people that aren't comfortable telling a player of that stature or a person of that stature no.
Yeah.
And I've learned to do it.
Yeah.
Because you can't just try to please people please all the time.
Yeah.
Right? It's like, for me, if I want to go to Minnesota and I want to see Nafisa, or if she's having a tough time with whatever it is, I need to be there for her because she was there for me.
Yeah.
So having people around you and surrounding yourself with good people, that's why I love working with who I'm with. I don't love working with Kyrie because of how talented he is, or working with Trae, or working with Candace Parker, or even Bobby Portis, or Doug. It doesn't matter. How are they as people? That's why I enjoy being around them, because they understand this life is about relationships.
Yeah. And training specifically is a really special job, because you really get to touch people one-on-one. Like, you get to do similar thing to this all day sometimes.
Yeah.
What do you like to leave people with? What is the encounter you like to have people walk away with? Obviously, you want to help them with their craft, which you're great at. But like you talk about, you know, spreading your faith and things like that. What is it that if you and I walk away from this conversation and I have something, what makes it a success to you?
I think that for me, it was, so there are two people that I looked up to the most in my life. It was my grandfather and then my dad. And one of my grandpa's quotes, and he passed away when I was 11, but it was, it doesn't matter how many points or touchdowns or home runs you hit, it's about how many times you can make someone smile throughout the day, right? So like, how are you helping that person make their life or make their day just a little bit better? So it's just having that presence of, I just want you to enjoy doing what you're doing, because you may be stressed out about, I need to accomplish this, I need to get this many makes, I need to make sure that this is right. At the end of the day, you're in the NBA, you're in the WNBA, you're very blessed to do what you're doing. Now we can attack the other parts from there.
Having that micro perspective, it seems like, is a theme with you. Like, you know what your priorities are, you know what the direction is. Do you have any macro, like, where I see myself in the next 5 years? Or is that, like you said, like in the beginning, maybe for me, I'm in the stage where goals really help me. They help me stay focused. They help me know what I'm moving towards. But I could see when you get to a certain point that, like you said, almost a goal is almost constricting you now because the world's kind of open to you.
Yeah.
Do you have anything that you want to hit within the next 5 years or something that you see at least vaguely?
No, I think that a lot of people, you know, fear holds a lot of people back. Like stating, here's my goal. And not just to you, but stating to everyone. A lot of people aren't comfortable saying, this is where I want to be. Because if you don't get it, well, what'd you do wrong?
Yeah.
Everyone knows what your goal was. Why didn't you reach it?
Yeah.
So again, it comes back to not worrying about what people are thinking. So it's like for me, I'm confident saying in 5 years, I want every single player in the world to have access to what I'm doing. Even if I'm training an NBA or WNBA player, they have the right to get better off what I'm teaching. They have the ability because this connects everyone in the world, right?
Yeah.
So we have to take advantage of this. How can I help a kid in the Philippines or help a kid in Asia or help a kid in Germany? How do I help that kid get better today? So, and because I know, again, I know what we're doing is right. I know that it gets results. Mm. So how can I reach this kid and help him get to the goals he wants to get to?
You're preaching, man. So what do you recommend, say to me, someone who maybe has a little hesitancy to claim my goals with such conviction? What would you say to me?
So here's my favorite story, and I'm going back to my grandpa. And for me, it's about what do you know more than anything else?
Yeah.
I know that what I do is why I'm here. What I'm doing is the right thing because of the level I've gotten to and the quickness I've gotten to it. But my grandpa, so this is his last day on earth, and him and my grandma were together forever, since the time that she was, I think, like 17.
Wow.
So he had a heart attack, and he was going through troubles, and the paramedics were trying to get his attention, and my grandma was like, Chet, can you hear me? Chet, can you hear me? Wouldn't respond. Chet, can you hear me? Wouldn't respond. And this is the last thing he ever said to my grandma. She goes, Chet, do you know who I am? And he looked at her right in the eye and said, you're my wife. So over anything else, he couldn't. That's the only thing he knew, 100% factual, that's my wife. And for me, it's like, what do you want to do? What are you great at? What do you feel like your purpose is? This is my purpose. Over anything else, I know that this is my purpose. And once you're confident in that, everything else falls in line.
Man, I got the chills. That was a hell of a story, dude.
Yeah.
That's something I'm taking home right now. I'm going home, getting my pen and paper and journaling about this. It's crazy how much your story, I didn't know, because, you know, we're different paths, but I'm taking a lot personally for myself.
Yeah.
I'm 24.
Yeah.
What's a piece of advice, assuming you would change nothing, there's no regrets.
Right.
I believe in that.
Mm-hmm.
What's a piece of advice you'd give yourself at age 24?
Patience. That's my number one word, still to this day, because it's hard.
Yeah.
It's really hard, because now that I've accumulated the clients and the following on social media and people saying, oh, you're amazing, oh, you're the GOAT, oh, and it's like, how do I be patient? Because it's not where I want to be. So I don't need you to tell me that I'm great at what I do. I don't need you to tell me I'm the best at what I do. I want to keep growing within day by day by day. Don't skip a day, because then someone else that's hungry is going to pass me up.
Is that something you needed to know at 24, or wish you had on more of a visceral level?
I think more so, yeah. I think it's just understanding that it's all going to come in time. You're not going to add 10 NBA players in a year. How do you get one? What's your connection? How do you help them get better? Do a good job with them for 2 or 3 years, then see what happens.
Yeah.
So it's just being patient with the domino. A lot of people think like the dominoes, all these 25 dominoes in a row, and as soon as you hit one, they all go falling at the same time. That's not how life works. You might have one domino that falls, and then all of a sudden it keeps shaking on the table, and then a year later, the next domino all of a sudden falls. And then all of a sudden, two dominoes fall. And all of a sudden, now it starts picking up. So it's like getting everyone to understand that it's we're here for a while, right? There's no reason to rush it.
Yeah.
So that's the way I've always looked at it.
And what I'm taking is, like, it can be easy for that first domino to fall, and you maybe don't know that the table's shaking.
Yeah.
And if you don't know what you said before, like, who are you?
Yeah.
What do you know? Then it can be easy to be like, was that the right domino?
Right.
Or should I be over here in this domino?
Yeah.
But I love that you preface this question by saying, like, just know what you're good at. Know what you're at. Because yeah. that's what I'm working through. I had that question of, how do I know which domino to knock over? But if I'm taking your advice, I'm really asking myself, what do I know? What am I good at?
Yeah.
How can I find my purpose and really just go with that?
Well, it's your passion, your purpose.
Your passion.
You know, what is that? Follow that.
Because purpose is a scary word, can be a scary word.
Yeah.
But passion. Let's start with joy. What do you really feel like you can help people with?
Right. You'll naturally, and that's why jumping in on youth sports, why are we pushing our kids towards our wants and our goals and our aspirations? Let them decide. Put them in as many things as possible.
Yeah.
And then let their passion take them where they want to go. So, like, my parents had me in every sport until I was eighth grade, and I begged and begged and begged, please let me just play basketball. Yeah. Please let me just.
I'm over baseball.
Yeah. I got every game I'd get hit, and I was like 98 pounds. I had a bruise all over my arm. I'm like, I'm done playing baseball.
It's too slow, man.
And I had to drag. My dad was the third base coach. He had me drag bunt every time because I was going to get on base and then steal two.
Fast,
yeah. Come on, man. Let me just hoop. Let me hoop. So, finally, like, when my parents did a great job with it, wasn't what they wanted to do.
Yeah.
Because we all, like, I had two other brothers. One played baseball and soccer. The other one ran cross country and hooped. And I had a sister that danced. So it wasn't like, it wasn't their wants. It's like, well, how do we tailor what our kids are wanting to do, and how do we put them in a position to be most successful as whatever they want to do?
Yeah.
So that, I think that's something that I've really learned from them, and that's inspired me to, you know, hopefully take with my future kids.
Sounds like you've had some great guidance from your parents.
Yeah.
And there's definitely something to be said about having someone, like, especially for males, I feel like a male role model is so important.
Right.
I want to be cognizant of your time. What can people, you know, Alex Bazell, man, people find you. What do you want people to know about you? First time hearing about you, who is Alex Bazell?
Man, that's a hard question.
Yeah, it is.
I mean, I'm just someone that has grown loving the game, and as I've always enjoyed getting the pleasure of helping someone else. And that's always the way even when I was young, I always wanted to, like, give presents because I wanted to see people's reaction. Like, I'd hand a gift and I'd be like this.
Yeah.
So, like, that's always just been, like, how I've been wired. And I think I've used that to a point of how I built my career. You know, a lot of people want to get to a certain level, but it's always about them. How do we make it about whoever you're helping or whoever you're working with? How do you help them? Then everything else falls in line after that. So I think for me, if I were to leave a room with someone, I would want someone to gain value in the conversation that we had. Like, man, that was a dope conversation. I can tell that person's genuine. I admire what they do and what they stand for, and I got a lot out of that conversation.
Yeah. I love that, man. I took a lot of value out of this. Is there anything that I missed that you feel like you need to be let the people know?
No.
No?
No.
Perfect.
Nothing, man.
I took a lot of value, man.
I appreciate that.
I love your perspective.
Yeah.
For my audience that may not know who you are yet, they sure will soon, but where can they find you? Where is a project that you want them to be at? Is it the Instagram, the Academy, a little both?
Yeah. My Instagram, if they go there, that's primarily where a lot of my work is through. And then my website's attached to that, so they can kind of dive in deeper, and my email's on there. And so, like, I'm very accessible and
cool, man.
Love answering questions. I'm getting a lot more these days, but I'm really taking pride in, that's why Derek's on, and we're taking pride in answering as many questions as we can, because it's
really,
it's about helping. Like, if I can help one person, they can help another person. It's just a tree of people helping each other. And like I said, at the end of the day, it doesn't matter. You know, you got to be confident
in
what you do.
You know what you should do one time is have this guy film you.
Yeah.
Get the phone and for 20 minutes answer questions.
Yeah.
And that's videos for a while.
Oh, yeah, for sure.
That's easy. People would love that, man. I'm sure you're getting a ton of questions.
Yeah.
I appreciate you, man.
My man,
that
I appreciate
awesome
you.
Conversation.
Yes, sir.
You're a natural.
Thank you.